Zimbabwe, and welcome to My Future. This is a program that brings together young people who constitute the majority of this country's population to interact with key decision makers, in this case, government ministers. My name is Farai Mwakutuya. I'll be your host over the next few weeks, and I invite you to join us as we bring together young people and key government ministers in different portfolios, including health, education, information and communication technology, as well as justice. The end and objective of all this is to solve the problems and challenges that are facing young people today to create a brighter future for themselves, as well as Zimbabweans of all walks of life. Tonight, we kick off quite appropriately with the Minister of Youth, Indigenization and Economic Empowerment. Honorable Minister Chris Mushowe, a pleasure to have you on this inaugural edition of My Future. Thank you for coming through, sir.
Thank you.
And your panel, I will introduce the top three panel here. You will be interacting with Honorable Tapiwa Mjawe, a counselor from Rua, Honorable Melissa Horiro, who is the child speaker in Zimbabwe's Child Parliament, and Honorable Lovemore Tapfumane, also a counselor all the way from Chitungwiza. Behind them are children drawn from all walks of life, all parts of this country, and they have burning questions that they want to put to you, and we look forward to you responding to them and interacting with these young people.
Sure.
But before that discussion gets underway, we'll take a short break, so do stay with us. Welcome back, and thank you for staying with us. This is My Future. My name is Farai Mwakutuya, and as I introduced earlier, we have the Honourable Minister, Honourable Chris Mushowe, the Minister of Youth, Indigenization and Economic Empowerment, and his panel of young people who want to speak to him and interact with him. This is the platform that is meant to facilitate that dialogue. There is a panel of two ladies and a gentleman, and purely because he is the only gentleman on the panel, I will begin with you, Honorable Lovemore Tapfumane, all the way from Chitungwiza. I know you've got some burning questions for the minister. Do go ahead.
Does what has the ministry done in order to expand the office or the room for other curriculum in this vocational skills like modeling, sports and music, which are not included into these vocational trainings?
I need to begin by informing you that we have more than 40 vocational training centers around the country, where a number of given fields are taught, and some of which you have already alluded to. There are quite a number of programs that you would want to see at these vocational centers, and I'm sure these we will take them on board. We want your contributions. It is you who must tell us what you want to see in these vocational centers, and I can assure you, during my term of office, we will make sure it is done. So let us know those aspects of programs that you feel must be included. And I want to thank you for that question, because those are some of the things we may not think of.
First and foremost, sir, I would like to thank the government, your ministry, for the establishment of the Junior Parliament and the Junior Council, who are a voice for the voiceless. They stand in for a number. Are the junior child representatives being taken seriously when they spill out the problems which their peers face? And do these relevant authorities really reckon to the voices of these children?
If you don't reckon to the voices of the future, then you don't belong to the future. So we as representatives in government, and you are one of them, because you are a junior candidate, you know, so you are part of us. But the truth is that everything and that is said by our young ones, you know, through their leadership, which is yourselves, is taken seriously by the government of Zimbabwe. And if it were not so, surely the president of this country would not come when there is a you know, when you open parliament and sit there to listen from the highest level of government, that is a clear indication that this government, which is led by His Excellency President Mugabe, takes seriously the views, concerns, and aspirations of the young ones. That's why you have seen that even our legislature has taken the trouble to make sure that we put in place legislation that ensures that violence, abuse, even rape, you know, against the children is a serious criminal offense. You can never get away with raping a child. And you know the sentence is predetermined, which is a sign of the commitment of government.
Junior parliament and junior council then faces a problem such that they have these campaigns to carry out, they have these messages to carry to their fellow peers, and they also have these rights to educate their peers on, but then they are not funded. They do not have the funds to travel to and from the rural areas to carry out these campaigns. What is the government doing to recognize this body, this child leadership body?
Sure, I agree with you. You should have some means to be able to traverse this country, mm-hmm. to go to the rural areas and talk to your peers there. But I think the will, political will, is there, and I'm sure you know that. Mm-hmm. What is not available in sufficient abundance is the resources. Even the senior parliamentarians, if you were to ask them, they are faced with the same problem. They don't have enough capacities in terms of resources to go back to their constituencies, for example. But for the young ones, I think you are a little bit luckier in that Zimbabwe has got the National Youth Council, which is represented right from the ward, from the village, in fact, and it up to the ward and to the district, provinces, and the national. And so we, in the circumstances where resources are not as readily available as they are, we believe that because of the educational network that we have in this country, it is also expected that you transmit some of these ones through, you know, schools and make sure an interaction with the youth council at national level for those who are in Harare, and at provincial levels for those who are in provinces, and even at district levels, so that this information is so important. And what are we doing as a ministry? We are setting up, you know, information centers, youth information centers in provinces and in districts. I know they have not yet covered the entire country. We have a few that you have made reference to, but we have got additional ones in Midlands. We have got one in Bindura. That is at least good news that we established those ones. But our thrust is that we need to have more of the information, youth information centers in rural areas, where we would not just wait for people to go there, but you can interact with them through internet, through all the technologies that are now available, that you can interact with your peers in rural areas directly.
Can you assure all young people out there who may be tuning in from all over the country that these youth councils are accessible to them? Because unfortunately, there is a perception out there that you must be connected to someone, you must know someone, or you must belong to a political party.
If there are youth councils, be they provincial, be they district, or ward-based, or national, which are accommodating the youth on the basis of their ethnicity, on the basis of their gender, on the basis of their religious beliefs or political beliefs, let us know, because they fall under this ministry. And we will not allow that.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, whoever does that is not part and parcel of the National Youth Council, because
mm-hmm.
national means every national of this country.
Mm-hmm.
So the question of different names, the question of different ethnic backgrounds or political backgrounds or religious backgrounds, there's no room in it. So it could be happening. If it is happening, bring it to our attention. And if it is individual within the structures, then we will plug them out.
My question is that we, as the junior councillors and parliamentarians, we want to know what the government is going to give us, our benefits as well, because we are doing a national duty.
Yes, thank you very much. I'm glad you said you are doing a national duty. If it is a national duty, then it's not employment. But if you regard it as employment, so you expect a salary, isn't that?
Yes.
But be as it may, and it is true, it is important, that what I think you are saying is government must make sure that the young ones who have aspirations, you know, to pursue their educational dreams must be given the opportunity.
Mm-hmm.
President Mugabe, being more of a teacher, an educationist than anything else, realized that our educational system remained bottlenecked, because we do not have enough universities here to carry all the A-level throughputs that comes every year. And you end up with students who have passed, who cannot go to university. Even if the money was there. Well, how? Because the university will insist on bottlenecking mechanisms, which says if you want to be a medical doctor, it must be 15 points.
Mm-hmm.
And it's 15 points with mathematics, physics, chemistry, and biology, or any three of those. But mathematics must be there. But we are talking of children who are in Mahenye, who are in Mzarabani, who are in Binga, who are in Menezi, who are in, you know, Lotito, at the periphery of this country, where the student-teacher ratio is still perhaps 1:50, if not more. Where the student book ratio is 1:20, 20 students must share one textbook. They may not be as fortunate as you are here in town, but that is a reality.
Honourable Minister, let me stop you there because we need to take a break, but clearly there are a lot of issues that are under discussion here, and this discussion will continue. So we'll take a short break now. My Future will be back shortly. Do stay with us. Welcome back to My Future. We thank you for staying with us. The Honourable Minister of Youth, Indigenisation and Economic Empowerment, Honourable Chris Mushowe, interacting with young people from different parts of this country. And we continue that interaction. I know that my brother in the corner there has a burning question, and I'll let him now pose that.
Thank you, Honourable Mushowe. My question is on the issue that we have previously discussed. Since you have really, you know, clearly stipulated that the initiative of the presidential scholarship is helping a minority of the youths of Zimbabwe, definitely due to economic hardships. So then, what then are we going to do with the majority?
No, thank you very much. I didn't say that the scholarship, presidential scholarship program, is the only initiative by government. I only indicated that one in response to a question which said, how do young students who are not able because of social circumstances to go to university be assisted? And I said that was one of the ways that government is assisting them, but it's not the only way. You also recall that there is a youth fund in my ministry, a youth fund that tries to help the young ones who would want to go into business, who would want to take up some projects. And that is also a way of empowering the youth. It's not every youth who will aspire to go to university or who will have the capability, intellectual capability, to go to university. But all young men and women, our children, must be assisted.
Honorable Minister, you mentioned the youth fund. We do know that in the past this fund has been abused, and because people have abused it, it might deprive young people such as these and others who may genuinely want to go into business to take up that opportunity and get access to it. What measures have you put
Yes. I was coming to that one. I have inherited a youth fund that has been, as you have put it, abused. But whether it was deliberately abused or people thought it was the way to do it, I don't know. But I can tell you with a very heavy heart, very sadly, that we have a 92% repayment failure as I'm sitting here. And the banks are asking for their money. Because it was meant to be a revolving fund where those who benefited would start projects and repay so that others can continue to benefit. But that is not the case. But what are we doing? And that is your question. We have said we are putting up a model that is transparent, that is accountable, and that we can agree with banks. And enough or sufficient due diligence, you know, taken before resources are just dished out. And we believe that giving people $500, $1,000, and say go and have a project that will, you know, generate some funds is not practical. Why don't we, if we've got that money, why don't we, for example, say the youth, look at province by province, start at provincial level and say, let me take Manicaland. You know, we have a company called Canes, which is folding up in Manicaland. Canes used to produce all the jam that we ate in this country. Canes would you know, package all the beans. And so we have, for those of you who may know Manicaland, we have all the people in Honde Valley where fruits grow in the bushes. Right up to Rusit. Then you come back to Nyanyazi irrigation scheme. You go to Mtema irrigation scheme. You go to Guyanga irrigation scheme. And all the irrigation schemes around there were producing beans, peas, you know, and all things that used to come to Canes for processing, horticultural products, vegetables. And it never, at its optimal operation, employed less than 1,000 people. So if we were to get 1,000 youngsters getting employment, who are also the owners of that company, as the youth, and the downstream benefits of all those small-scale farmers who will benefit, we will have resuscitated the industry. We will have given livelihood to all the communities around there. That's the kind of thing that we are looking at. But we need to clean up, you know,
does
the
that,
fund.
Does that clean up include going after the bad apples who didn't pay back the money?
We need to know why they have not paid up. If the reasons are something that was beyond their means, then perhaps you say, oh, well, if the money was stolen, so what can he do? But you see, due care should have been taken.
True.
But we will look at all those and see what needs to be done. But as a way forward, we think we need to share these views with you, mm-hmm. the youth. Because it is you are the beneficiaries. Mm-hmm. So once we agree and say this is a model, and this is just an example of a model that we are thinking of as a ministry, but we want your contribution.
Indeed.
Yeah.
I know my sister here has something she also wants to put to you, Minister.
Thank you, Honorable Minister. Firstly, would like to thank you for the imposition of the indigenization policy. We are really appreciating it. But my question is, what has the government done so far, or what is it doing so that the indigenization policy becomes more effective to you?
Yes, the indigenization policy would have be more effective than what it is. But I can assure you that it is bearing fruits. We have quite a number of companies, external or foreign investors who have come, joined with our people, and they are together. But the majority of them are in the area of extractive industries, the mining, be it gold, be it nickel, or any other. You know, that's why you are seeing government is even saying, even those we call Makorokoza, but most of the youths in the rural areas are not informal, you know, extractive companies. But government has said, no, we don't want to see that word, you know, Makorokoza. Formalize them. Give them tools to work with and let them exploit it.
Honorable Minister, there have been pronouncements on the National Youth Policy, which we understand is being revived. Could you tell us the model that your ministry plans to implement this going forward? Will it be the same as we knew it before when it first came, or is it going to be done differently?
National Youth Service is not peculiar to Zimbabwe. I don't know of any of the first world governments where there's no national youth service. I know many of the African governments have national youth service. You see? But what is it? Mm. What does it aim to achieve? You know? National youth service, as we are saying, it's youth service. The youth are giving service to their nation. That's why we call it National Youth Service. You need to know and believe in yourself. And it can be done either through education, you know, put it in our curriculum, so that our children will, yes, must do what other children do, must know what other children know, must understand what other children understand. But above it all, the only difference is they will know they are not British, they are not American, they are not Nigerian, they are Zimbabwean. So it's in our resuscitating the National Youth Service, we are asking ourselves questions as government, what has gone wrong? Where did we miss it?
Are you speaking to these young people?
Yeah.
Because perhaps they don't want to dress up in those fatigues.
We are going to go to them. Uh-huh. But we must put a framework first. And we'll go to them and say, and like I'm saying to you, I can see some of you nodding your heads, that it is not good to believe that a man must marry a man and a woman must marry a woman. It's a foreign, you know, value that is diabolical to us. So we want you to tell us how you want it done. We don't want a situation where some young Zimbabweans who think they are less Zimbabweans than others, and these ones are more Zimbabweans than others. Let them do it if they think they are more Zimbabweans. We don't want to do it because we don't think... No. If you are a national of this country, a national youth service is part of you.
Well, there you have it, and we must end it here. Thank you so much, Honorable Chris Mushoe for coming through and interacting with our young people. I must also thank the young people who came here as well and put their questions to you. We hope that this is not the end of the interaction.
Sure.
We hope to have you back and even interact beyond this platform.
Sure.
But that does it for this edition of My Future. I thank you for tuning in and making time to listen to this program, to watch this program. And as we said, this is a platform for young people to come up with solutions to challenges facing them today to secure a brighter future for not only themselves, but for Zimbabwe as a whole. My name is Farai Mwakutuya. Be sure to join us again next time. Good night.